Hello everybody, my name is Lubomira Dimitrova from Bulgarian Development Agency, and today we are going to have our third lecture on the module number 7, Business Development and Fundraising, part of Compass Project. Today we are going to speak about the types of fundraising which you can use to establish your own business. Feel free to write down your questions and send them back to me in order to answer them in the beginning of our next lecture. Before we go further in describing what loans are, you should have in mind that there is always the possibility just to save money in order to invest them in once without having the need to ask for money from different institutions in advance. So before you take the decision to use whatever one of the measures which I'm going to explain in the future, just have in mind that there is also always the possibility to save money, to extend the period in which you are going to establish your company and then have the money on your own. However, as this is not the case, today we are going to speak about the different types of fundraising which you can use, the first one of which are the loans. For taking a bank loan to start your business, you should bear in mind the 5 C's of credit covered: collateral, character, capital capacity, and other conditions required of the lender. In any case, before going to the bank, you must have these things in mind. Firstly, the standard business loan or the line of credit or the credit card loan. A standard small business loan or just loan requires you to pay a regular monthly payment for a set period of time. The payment amount and the terms don't adjust with time unless it's a variable rate loan. Some banks will extend you a line of credit to help fund your small businesses, similar to money given to homeowners for home improvements and various expenses. Here the payment changes depending on what the owner uses. Besides the consequences of default, which may include seizing your assets and collateral, one of the risks of getting a small business loan or line of credit from a bank is that the bank might require you to sign up for a business bank account to make more automatic withdrawals to pay the obligation. And if your default, the bank might be able to garnish that account. As for the case of credit card loan, small business owners can take cash advance for a small business credit card. This loan is risky due to the higher interest rate that commonly come with credit card accounts, the variability of credit card terms, and the fact that this is a revolving account. There is a temptation to keep using available funds in a revolving account, which could cause a small business debt to burnish for many years. An equity fund is a mutual fund that invests principally in stocks. It can be actively or passively managed. Equity funds are also known as stock funds. Stock mutual funds are practically categorized according to the company size, the investment size of the holding and the portfolio and geography. The size of the equity fund is determined by the market capitalization, while the investment style reflected and fund stock holding. And it is also to categorize equity mutual funds. Equity funds are also categorized by whether they are domestic or international. These can be broad market, regional, or single country funds. Some specialty equity funds target business sectors such as healthcare, commodities, and real estate. There are some risks which you have to have in mind. The first one of them is macroeconomic risk. Share prices are sensitive to the development in the economy, such as the change of invest rates, value of currency, inflation rate, government policies, tax rates, and central bank policies. All these tend to influence the prices of equity securities. For instance, an increase in inflation rate leads to the rise in equity risk premium, which depresses the equity market. Similarly, a weakening currency dampens the equity markets. There is also a liquidity risk. The liquidity of a stock is a function of its trading volume. A contraction in the volume of securities could affect the fund manager's ability to transact, which in turn could affect the fund's overall. The funds that invest in small cap or unlisted stocks are more prone to such risks. The inability to sell security due to the lack of volumes could lead to substantial losses in the mutual funds. There is also a non-diversification risk. A mutual fund aims at eliminating or minimizing internal or company-specific risk through diversification. However, at times, a particular sector or segment of capital market may acquire a sizable proportion of the fund's total assets and expose to the risks of non-diversification. For example, if mid-cap stocks acquire a majority stake in an equity diversified fund's corpus, the fund could be substantial risk of the markets were to turn bearish in the near future. This is because mid-cap stocks are the first to bear the brunt where the market declines. There are also corporate performance risks. Fund managers look for undervalued companies with strong fundamentals that are likely to show improved operational performance over time. However, companies may not perform as per the investors' expectations due to the increasing costs or reduced revenue. The radically changing consumer performances can also lead to a lack of demand for the company's products and result in underperformance. This could drastically affect the NAV of a fund as the stock's underperforming companies are harmed on the stock exchange. In addition to this, an equity fund that invests in overseas securities is subject to the following risks. There is a currency risk, which occurs if a fund invests a proportion of its corpus in stocks whose prices are denominated in foreign currencies. It is exposed to the risk of currency movement. The distribution of income and correspondingly the value of the fund are adversely affected by any changes in the value of the foreign currencies relative to the Indian rupee. There is also a country and political risks. These are the risks associated with the deteriorating relationships between countries. Some of the possibilities include immobilization of overseas financial assets and introduction of extraordinary exchange controls. Such risks are also include a country's inability to meet its financial obligations that could adversely affect the value of the fund.
Debt financing occurs when a firm raises money for working capital or capital expenditures by selling bonds, bills, or notes to individuals and institutional investors. In return for lending the money, the individuals or institutions become creditors and receive a promise the principal and interest on the debt will be repaid. The other way to raise capital in the debt market is to issue shares in stock in a public offering. This is called equity financing. When a company needs money, it can take three roads to obtain financing: cash, debt, or some hybrid of the two. Equity represents an ownership stake in the company. It gives the shareholder a claim on the future earnings, but it does not need to be paid back. If a company goes bankrupt, equity holders are the last in the line to receive money. The first investors in the line are the lenders. These are the investors that provide the company with the debt financing. The amount of investment loan, referred to as the principal, must be paid back. Companies can obtain debt financing through banks and bondholders. Debt financing can be difficult to obtain, but for many companies it provides funding at lower rates than equity financing, especially in periods of historically low interest rates. Another perk to debt financing is the interest on debt is tax deductible. Still, adding too much debt can increase the cost of capital, which reduces the present value of the company. Some investors in debt are the only interest in principal protection, while others want to return in the form of interest. The rate of interest is determined by the market rates at the creditworthiness of the borrower. Higher rates of interest imply a greater degree of default and therefore a higher level of risk. Higher interest rates help to compensate the borrower for the increased risk. On the other side of a high yield investment is a high-risk borrower. In addition to payment interest, debt financing often requires the borrower to adhere to certain rules regarding the financial performance. These rules are referred to as covenants. Now we are going to see how to measure our debt financing. One metric analysis used to measure and compare how much of a company's capital is being financed with the debt financing is the debt-to-equity ratio. For example, if total debt is 2 billion euros and the total stockholders' equity is 10 billion euros, the debt-to-equity ratio is 1 to 5, or 20%. This measures for the every euro of debt financing, there is a 5 euro of equity. In general, a low debt-to-equity ratio is preferable than the high one, though certain institutions and industries have a higher tolerance for debt than others. Both debt and equity can be found on the balance sheet. But the question remains how to use debt and when to raise equity. Generally speaking, most companies will choose to raise debt financing if it has the cash flow, the assets, and the ability to repay the debts. Companies that either do not qualify or pose too great of a risk for lenders are better suited to raise equity financing. Startups in this case are a great example. These companies don't have a track record, have a limited assets for collateral, and may not yet be profitable or cash flow positive. This is too risky for a prospect for lenders. Investors, however, can accept these risks thanks to the prospect of high return should the company succeed. Conversely, a company with an existing debt load may not be able to obtain any new debt financing. It's similar to being denied a mortgage loan. The bank cannot accept the risk of weak cash flow, too much existing debt, or a poor credit history. In these cases, companies can seek out equity investors instead of lenders, because equity investors will accept more risk if the potential future rewards are sufficiently high. As an investor, monitoring how a company chooses to manage their ratio of equity and debt levels is important, as too much or too little of either can be a bad thing. Too much debt can lead to bankruptcy. Too much equity can dilute existing shareholders and harm returns. The key is to find the balance between these two. As for our next source of funding, we are going to speak about grants. Before going further, I should let you know that grants are not repayable funds or products distributed by one party or grant makers, often a government department, corporation, foundation, or trust, to a recipient, often but not always a non-profit entity, educational institution, business, or an individual. In order to receive a grant, some form of grant writing, often referred to as either a proposal or an applicant, is required. Most grants are made to fund a specific project and require some level of compliance and reporting. The grant writing process involves an applicant submitting a proposal to a potential funder, either on the applicant's own initiative or in response to a request for proposal from the funder. Other grants can be given to individuals such as victims of natural disasters or individuals who seek to open a small business. Sometimes grant makers require grant seekers to have some form of a tax-exempt status, be a registered non-profit organization or a local government. For example, tiered funding for a freeway are very large grants negotiated at government policy level. However, smaller grants may be provided by a government agency or a municipal government. The European Commission of the EU provides financial through numerous specific calls for project proposals. This may be within the framework program, although there are many 7-year programs that are renewed that provide money for various purposes. This may be structural funds, youth programs, or educational programs. They are also occasional one of the grants to deal with the unforeseen aspects or special projects and teams. Most of these are administrated through what are called national agencies, but some are administered directly through the European Commission in Brussels. Another funding body in Europe is the Council of Europe. This is a separate from the European Union. Similarly, there are calls and various projects that are funded by the councils. But don't stop there. Right now, I cannot tell you in details about the different grant opportunities in your hometown or country, but I am sure that if you take your time and if you study in details the different opportunities on a local, regional, national, or even European level, you will be surprised how many opportunities you are going to find. Furthermore, don't underestimate the opportunities of looking for universities which can support your business idea or your project with the direct funding. Have in mind that receiving a grant does not mean that somebody is giving money for free. During the whole period in which you're going to cherish and establish your project, you're going to be monitored and you have to be very, very, very careful. And once again, we came again to the readings for our today's lecture. As you can see, this time I have chosen for you two optional and two obligatory articles. As you may see, this time our obligatory articles are more like in the form of a tips rather than an academic or scientific article. You have 14 creative financing methods for startups and 10 ways to finance your business. As for the optional, we have when the startup innovations pour in the gale of creative destruction and the venture capital and the professionalization of startup firms' empirical evidence. The optional articles are scientifically based ones which are not very related to the ones from the obligatory articles, but the reason why they are optional is that I think that they are going to give you a better idea of what types of funding there could be in a more scientific manner, which may not be that essential for you opening a company. However, I strongly recommend you to read the four of them. And last but not least, I'm going to present you the resources for this lecture. And once again, feel free to check them up and read them on your own, finding more inspiration and information which may be useful for you in the future. Well, that was it for our today's session. If you want to read more, you can find the sources for this lecture, as well as you can seek as much information as you can from internet. Thank you very much and see you next week.